Last night, I made a video about the purge of Paul Joseph Watson, Laura Loomer, Miley Yiannopoulos, Farrakhan, etc. If you didn't watch the video, I recommend it. It's on my main channel, youtube.com/timcast. It is a different channel from this one. The main points, just because I'll go over them in here. Actually, I don't want to bury the lead, because this often happens. Donald Trump, the president of the United States, has retweeted Paul Joseph Watson, his YouTube video talking about being banned by Facebook. This is a huge development. He retweeted Paul earlier. The support for me has been incredible. This could actually lead to some genuine change. Keep up the pressure. Don't let it rest. He also retweeted Lauren Southern when she said, laughing my ass off at establishment conservatives who think they won't be labeled the new dangerous extremist voices when those to the right of them are all banned. Good luck with that one, guys. I don't want to bury the lead. There's a lot to go over. Essentially, the main points that are important for my main video, the media, Facebook issued this story in a release to the media under embargo. This was confirmed by Taylor Lorenz, who wrote the story for The Atlantic. That means they said to all these media companies, we're going to ban these people, but don't report this until this time. Here's where it gets even weirder. When the story was finally released from embargo, no one had been banned, which means Facebook informed the news organizations under embargo before telling the users, what is this? What rights do we have on these platforms? They've become too powerful, and now they're flicking, you know, they're just deleting and banning people, and it's destroying lives. It's mind-blowing to me that you have people on the left laughing, saying things like, but my private platform or whatever. What? When has the left ever been in favor of letting corporations run rampant? I was in a Facebook thread with someone who said, look, up until they actually change the law, this is what the rules are. And I said, oh, okay, heaven forbid a group of people get together and lobby the government to make a change to protect the commons. What world is this? But this is actually really fascinating to see the president retweeting these individuals. This is really huge. And it's not just that he retweeted these individuals. It's that he also tweeted this. So surprised to see conservative thinkers like James Woods banned from Twitter and Paul Watson banned from Facebook. Important clarification. James Woods is under a suspension until he deletes the tweet he posted. My understanding is that he's refusing to. The tweet he said was like hashtag hang them all or something, and Twitter said you can't do that. Now, I'm going to agree with Twitter on this one. You can't make a call to violence. I will also point out the double standard, because there are a lot of hashtags that went around for a long time that were calls to violence that Twitter did nothing about. So I'm not surprised James Woods is saying no. Because when you have... I'm not going to say them. I'm not going to say what the hashtags are, but there's two off the top of my head that I can't actually speak because I could get in trouble on YouTube. There was one about ending the lives of certain people and another viral trend about attacking people unprovoked. These were all fine. Twitter had no problem with this. In fact, there are Antifa accounts that are active for a long time, doxing people. As I pointed out to Jack Dorsey on the Joe Rogan podcast, 2 months ago, you've got active Antifa accounts that are calling for violence that you don't do anything about. So why should James Woods be singled out in this regard? Now, I don't mean he's the only one getting targeted. Of course, many people on the anti-war left are getting banned too, which is part of a big part of the problem because, I find myself in an interesting position in that I really, really agree with a lot of the anti-war left people. I think Glenn Greenwald coming out, just ragging on the Russia Gators nonstop, opposing a lot of military intervention from the U.S., good stuff. I don't agree with everything he does. So I'm kind of in between that group, mostly because they tacitly agree with the left-wing identitarians. I'm not about that. But here's the thing. When people come out and say, hey, we shouldn't bomb this country, guess what? They get banned too. If you support this regressive, neoliberal, corporatist, Democrat, neocon position, whatever you want to call it, the old establishment, you're safe. You're fine. And it's the people who oppose that system, who are in the anti-war left and happen to be conservative or Trump supporters, who are under fire right now. Perhaps because they don't want Trump to win and he wasn't supposed to. But Trump also tweeted this. I'm continuing to monitor the censorship of American citizens on social media platforms. This is the United States of America, and we have what's known as freedom of speech. We are monitoring and watching closely. What does that mean? As Cassandra said, the time to stop watching and start acting was like a year ago, over a year ago. William Legate says, Trump doesn't care, LMAO. I can't believe you all still have faith in him. And she said, I mean, I don't. Let me point one thing out. What can Donald Trump do? Okay, this seriously comes down to an issue of Congress, but more importantly, it comes down to an issue of state level legislation. What needs to happen And this is a really, really great article from Will Chamberlain, actually, who replied to Donald Trump. He said, in the instance of Paul and James Woods being banned, he said, "It's time to start treating this as a civil rights violation and writing laws both in Congress and in state legislators to solve the problem once and for all. Platform access is a civil right." It's a fantastic article, by the way. Will recently revived the website Human Events, which is a conservative magazine. He's done two really big articles. They've like blown up. One is called Checkmate, explaining Trump's strategy for how he, you know, how they ended up ending the Mueller probe. But this one's really, really interesting. I'm not going to go through the whole thing. I might do another read on this later. But essentially, Will points out a few really important things. Actually, I think we should get into it first. He tells this really amazing story about Lyndon Johnson. He would have his employees drive through the South back to his home in, I believe, Austin, through the Deep South. He had Austin, and they were black. And he tried one time asking him to take his dog, and they explained they couldn't because they have to drive hours to try and find somewhere they can eat. They had to drive hours, or they had to crap on the side of the road because no one would allow them to use their facilities or enter their buildings. And that kicked Lyndon Johnson in the butt, saying, "Whoa, maybe we shouldn't allow businesses to do this. Think about the problems it causes." So more importantly, though, Will points out you have a bunch of red states. These red states can easily pass laws in their states requiring that if these companies want to operate within their jurisdiction, they have to do X, Y, and Z, which is really fascinating because in Washington, D.C., political affiliation and source of income are protected human rights. Why is Twitter exempt from human rights law in Washington, D.C.? I don't know. Perhaps it's because there hasn't been a sufficient challenge. Perhaps that's what needs to happen. But Will also brings up an extremely, extremely important, seriously, wow, I did not know this. Let me see if I can find it. There's this case right here, the recently decided Supreme Court case. Packingham v. North Carolina is instructive. He says, in this case, Lester Packingham, a North Carolina resident and registered sex offender, posted to Facebook about an experience in traffic court. North Carolina had a law banning registered offenders from using social media sites. Packingham demonstrates what happens when the governments try to use regulation to try and restrict access to social media sites. The facts of Packingham are pretty simple. The government of North Carolina, for perfectly sensible reasons, passed a law that prohibited convicted sex offenders, from using social media. The Supreme Court, in a unanimous decision, found this speech constraint unconstitutional and used very basic settled law to do so. Simply put, under long-standing First Amendment law, the government cannot restrict your access to the public square. Kennedy explains, by prohibiting sex offenders from using those websites, North Carolina with one broad stroke bars access to what for many are the principal sources for knowing current events, checking ads for employment, speaking and listening in the modern public square, and otherwise exploring the vast realms of human thought and knowledge. In sum, to foreclose access to social media altogether is to prevent the user from engaging in the legitimate exercise of First Amendment rights. So here we have it, a unanimous Supreme Court decision holding that the First Amendment prohibits federal and state governments from restricting your access to social media. This is important because it sets in precedent. The Supreme Court unanimously views that social media is the modern public square. Now we have building blocks. It needs to be protected. Let me explain another important thing here. Back at the main point, Lauren Southern got retweeted. She said, laughing at the establishment conservatives who think they won't be labeled the new extremists. Of course they will. They're calling Paul Joseph Watson an extremist. He's 100% opposed to violence and condemns it all the time. Sure, he's offensive. You might not like his opinions, but he denounces all forms of violence. Why was he taken down? Why was he called dangerous? Lauren follows up. This actually goes for dissident leftists as well. There have been some seriously great conversations happening about censorship, and I'm thankful for that. I just wish more in the mainstream understood they aren't so far removed, safe from it. She says, but I disavowed extreme rhetoric like 40 times last week. Buckle up, bucko. Doesn't matter because we're all on the same censorship train here. And here's a story from The Guardian. The Republican platform is extremist, and so is anyone who supports it. They've also repeatedly called it far right. The solution, as laid out by Will, is actually really simple. You cannot ban someone for legal speech. However, this doesn't give the government the right to ban anyone. See, this is the problem. Right now we're hearing arguments, as Will actually points out, this one from Tiana Lowe, that she thinks if you give the government to the right to regulate these platforms, then Obama gets in and now he can now he's going to impact conservatives. No, that was the point of this. The government unanimously decided, the Supreme Court, that they don't have the right. The government does not have the right to suppress speech, to restrict access to this platform. What they can do is say to the private companies, you also don't have this right. The important thing we're talking about here is that these civics have not been developed yet. Social media is new. It is a new phenomenon. It has only recently gained so much power that it's become a problem. We look back at the regulation on, say, the electric company. We look back on, say, OSHA and all these things that just exist that were like, oh, yeah, well, that makes sense. You can't do X, Y, and Z with your business. You can't lie, cheat, and steal. These things make sense. But there was a point where you could. There was a point where if you were working on a construction site, you didn't have to wear a helmet. You didn't have to wear a vest. And then certain standards were applied via through regulation or insurance companies they developed over time. And now it's a normal thing. Seatbelts, for instance. Man, I remember when you didn't have to wear seatbelts, and there was a big argument over whether the government has a right to make it illegal to not wear a seatbelt. Now everyone just wears their seatbelts. I'm not saying I like that, you know, because I actually think, man, if somebody doesn't want to wear a seatbelt, I don't know. But here's the thing. What we're talking about is the government can't restrict speech. The government can regulate social media platforms to tell them you can't restrict speech. That's what needs to happen. And the final point I want to make with Lauren Southern here, there's a poem that's often cited, and I don't want to conflate this with World War II or anything, but it's the First They Came poem. That means so much more than just what happens in World War II, and it doesn't always have to do with life or death situations, but I bring it up because what it's really telling us is, look to who's being targeted, and know that when they're gone, they'll come for the next line over and over again. The way I describe it is we're all standing on this island that's got massive 20-foot cliffs with waves crashing in and eroding the cliffside. Right now, Paul Joseph Watson is dangling from that cliff. A year ago, it was actual white supremacists. The American Nazi Party was on Twitter. The cliff was far extending, and you had the fringe far-right neo-Nazi types on Twitter actively campaigning for their politics. Twitter did the snap, the cliff eroded, and they were gone. Then who was next? The white nationalist types. The overlap with the worst of the worst, but who try and dress it up nice and sound smarter. Snap, they're gone. A bunch of now Facebook has wiped them out. Now we're getting to the snarky, offensive conservatives, Paul Joseph Watson. He's hanging from the cliff because Facebook's already axed him. Instagram has axed him. What happens when Twitter and YouTube say, you know what, we're going to fall in line with Facebook? Who's next? Lauren Southern? Who's next? A regular conservative. Do you think Donald Trump will be able to win the presidency if the biggest supporters of his are wiped out? And I'm not talking about the fringe extremists. There's a reason why there wasn't as big of a pushback when the American Nazi Party gets purged. As much as a lot of people want to point out, hey, man, free speech, we all kind of go, yeah, well, you know, no one really likes those guys. So when they get deleted from the platform, we're kind of like, there's a line, right? But this is the problem. Twitter took it too far. And now they're actually creating a situation where all political speech is going to need to be protected. Like, the point I'm trying to make is there will come a point when the cliff is eroding. As I see Paul Joseph Watson slip, getting banned from Facebook and Instagram, I see Lauren Southern standing next to him because she's in a similar space to where he is. Why Paul Joseph Watson got targeted? Probably because he worked with InfoWars. So I think Lauren will be next. And she rightly points out, then the conservatives, and then me. There's going to be center-right individuals, people like, you know, I don't know. I'm not going to name anybody because, you know, I don't want to apply politics to individuals. But there are people who are center-right, libertarian types. Oh, nope. Sorry. Full stop. I do got something. It's going to hit someone center-right like Luke Rutkowski if we are change. You don't got to like what he does. You don't got to like his opinion. You don't got to like any of their opinions. But Luke just posted this image last night where he no longer has access to his publishing privileges on Facebook. This is a story that's probably not going to get picked up as much because Luke isn't a staunch Trump supporter. He's actually pretty opposed to Trump's foreign policy. He's a center-right libertarian type. He believes in small government. And here we can see he no longer has access to publish on his own page because of other pages that he had nothing to do with getting banned. And so here's my understanding. There's an exploit on Facebook where you can make someone an admin. It used to be you could just do it without their permission. And that's what happened to Luke. Then you break the rules and it bans everyone. So this is an old exploit that Luke's getting hit with. But the point is, Luke had some page. Luke was an admin of some pages he didn't know about. Someone added him. They broke the rules. Now Luke. So what happens is that erosion falls and people get swept up in it. You know, so Luke didn't break any rules at all. But now his main page with, I think, you know, one of his main pages has 600,000 or so followers he can't publish to anymore. So yes, the cliff is eroding. And Luke is a center-right, he's pretty anti-Trump. He's a pretty anti-Trump libertarian type because he just generally opposes the establishment, the government, regardless of what its power structure is. Who do you think's next? It's going to be moderate liberals. It's going to be all those who oppose the establishment. It will be Bernie Sanders voters. The people who refuse to support Hillary Clinton and Joe Biden, and the establishment will crawl itself back out of the grave and resurrect the old disgusting policies that caused the financial crisis and made everyone suffer. Something needs to be done. I'll say this. I recommend you go to, I'll put this link in the description. HumanEvents.com will write this really long article explaining why conservatives need to get behind this. Liberals aren't going to because in their mind, they're like, haha, we win, but they don't get it. They do not understand it. You give them this power, don't fight back, you're not going to win in the end. First, they come for the conservatives, then they come for you. I'll have more videos coming up for you later today. Stick around, next video at 1 p.m.